feel like some, it's like a, it's a living, breathing thing. And so some days it can be grumpy, like Mark was saying. It's worth pushing through the tough days with it, though. It's like any, it's like a relationship. It is an intimate relationship with the instrument. And
yeah, I think the reason, you know, it takes so long to be able to do it. Maybe that's part of why it's so enjoyable, because it takes so long to get there.
Especially when you've had one instrument for a long time and you know the strengths and weaknesses and know how to play into the flaws of the instrument, and you just get to know your instrument in a really intimate way.
People often ask, I'm sure, all three of us, it certainly comes to me a lot, is like, which is harder to play, the violin or the guitar, or the violin and whatever? And I think there's an equity of answer to that, in that now we could creep a little bit into education with this, but like how to learn. You know, I'm really fascinated by not what to learn, but how to learn. And I love the idea that to really connect with this, to echo what Lyndsay was just saying and what John was just saying, is the idea of not giving any concern to the steering wheel right out the gate. The engine room. The idea of learning to draw this stick in a perpendicular fashion across these strings and get a sound that is pleasing to you. And a little bit of it is also getting used to the sound, because even a pleasing tone can be arresting when you're first doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the whole idea of just put it on the shoulder. Just don't even worry about this yet. And feel the difference in the pressure, you know, being light with it, like Lyndsay was doing so beautifully. I'm not doing it as well, but it's the idea of when you shift, and just getting used to that, and then find a string buddy. Heartbeat of all this is that music is organized sound, so a pulse. And now you can play that fiddle tune that you've heard, but you don't know what to do with it on your fiddle yet. But you'd know what to do with it in your mouth. And now you're playing the fiddle. But you're not going to this yet, because when we go to this, it's a whole different sense of correctness and things that we need to try to attain to. But boy, if you get the feeling of just walking around the house doing this with your step, you know, like, okay, this.
When you walk, you know, you walk in music cadence. Right?
Oh, I love that.
Every step, but then you double time it. That is so damn fun. It is so fun to do that. And then
you get that feeling. And so you've made a really important connection. And then you can get to the steering wheel. Okay, I want to be quiet.
I love that. Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah.
Everybody in this room can play the fiddle. It's you can do it, but sometimes it's how you get introduced to it, because you want to feel that. That's a great feeling. And everybody in this room can do that. It's so good.
I love that analogy of the left hand is the steering wheel, and the right hand is like the pulse driving forward.
The engine, yeah.
The minute we start going to
yeah, you need a mechanic at that point.
Now you're starting to be kind of assessed within yourself and with others, and that can hold you back. Do that before you put it away. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Should we play? Questions? Concerns? Wow, Vassar licks.
Should we play a tune?
Maybe
I don't know.
We could play a Vassar tune.
Sure. You guys probably going to be better at this than me. I'll accompany.
Maybe we should play lots of fiddle blues.
We could.
Sure.
I'll do some counterpoint while you guys do it. Oh, and for those of you who, and please be, you know, it's great to be honest and all that stuff. Who does not know who Vassar Clements is? It's okay. My heart feel really good that there's practically everyone here knows who he is. And sir, you will come to know here a little bit of what made Vassar's playing so magical, in that he was listening to other instruments and other kinds of music than what he was playing at the time. And it never left him, and this is what happened.
Yeah, he was very just free and very raw with what, and truly, I don't know, improvising.
In a really lyrical way, he was raw.
Yeah.
Raw lyricism, if that makes any sense. Yeah. Seems like an oxymoron, but it, yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Thanks.
I want to make a shout out. I don't know if she's still here, because she is a very, very busy person and a vital part of the infrastructure of the Suwannee Fests here. This was an idea that our good friend Lee Hunter came up with, and I just want to give a shout out to her, because this is really kind of a fun, it's a workshop, but it really is something that you all come to and you can all learn whether you're playing the instrument or not. And I love it when music kind of goes into that space, because we, as educators, we want to make things accessible, and we want to invite people in. Always leave the door open and invite people in. So we're kind of like Fuller Brush salespeople, too, because we really want to sell the, because we love the fiddle and we want to sell it to everyone. We'd love for the entire world to play the fiddle.
Play a fiddle, yeah.
Wouldn't that be great?
Right.
That would be an awesome thing.
Instead of, yeah, have a coat.
Because you can see what's going on with just three fiddles. There's all these textures and all these different subplots. Like kind of like those shows that happened during the pandemic, you know, like the Queen's Gambit. Oh God, what a great, you know, all these different layers of things going on. I'm comparing what we're doing up here to the Queen's Gambit, which I'm not sure if that's a good idea. But.
I like the blurry lines that you can really tell that the fiddle has when we're all playing together. You know, it's just fretted instruments have so many boundaries, you know. Mm-hmm. They're like, they're still stuck on chords, but we really could just slide around and blur through whatever happens and then find ourselves somewhere.
There are styles of music around the world where people have really taken advantage of the fact that there's no frets. I mean, golly, that's...
I love that.
That's such a cool thing. And it's, and you know, yeah. And it's great to be just a little off, because we have to remind ourselves that a lot of us are used to a scale of music that has only 12 identifiers, 12 names for 12 notes, out of way more notes than 12. Mm-hmm. There's like the maqam system, which is Arabic music, has these half sharps and half flats, which is just like the best. Do you mess around with that at all? Either one of you? When we hear it, it could sound like maybe like it's out of tune to us, mm-hmm. but they're actually playing these notes that we don't normally play.
It's because our ears aren't acclimated to it in American music.
Right.
Or Western music.
Western music.
Yeah. That's another way the fiddle is like the human voice, too. Just all the in-between notes. And sometimes the note's just perfectly sharp or perfectly flat. That's the note that really hits you emotionally. Like, same with a great singer. You know, it's a human voice isn't on a fretboard.
Yeah, like being in tune is not always like you're just because it's not always right in with your tuner, mm-hmm. you know. Do you know what I'm saying? When you look at your tuner and it says you're in tune, it doesn't necessarily mean it's like exactly the right note that you're going for.
That's the thing that's cool about the blues. The idea of the blues is kind of the moan and kind of, you know, not quite hitting it. I love hearing a lot of old field recordings where people are like not quite hitting the note, they're a little flat or sharp a little, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's like really cool.
It's very cool.
It's very cool, yeah. When I remember the last time I heard Bill Monroe sing, he sang Blue Moon of Kentucky and he just couldn't quite hit that high note. And it was delicious. It was so cool. Because it was so human. And he was going for it. You know that he was bringing everything he could to it. He was, yeah. And it wasn't quite in tune, and that made it glorious to me. Mm. It's Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's beauty in every little turn with what we do, with what all of us do with this stuff. And making it your own is really fun too. I mean, like, I remember I did my first recording I ever did in 96, I did a version of Old Joe Clark, like I had given it a passport and told it to go to India. And I called it Old Joe's Deli, as in New Delhi, as in India. And it was really fun to put to dress up a different suit of clothes on Old Joe Clark, treating
yeah,
it kind of
hear,
more like a
raga.
Can
we hear like a little a taste of that?
Gosh, let's see if I can get away with this. Help justify why I set it up. Something like that. That was pretty rough, but you get the idea. Yeah, ragas are really cool. They tell a story, and it's very it has a very meditative drone-like quality, and it allows you to really kind of settle into something, and then they get into these cycles of rhythms, like where a whole pattern can be like 64 beats. 60, and you're going, no way.
I can't count that high.
But if you count it, and then you go, oh my God, they've got it. That's exactly what's going on. The whole cycle of 60.
Yeah.
Crazy.
That's my
so
mind.
Cool. So people, what's the point? The point is, this thing has traveled all over the world, and lots of variations, including adding a string.
Right, or a few, yeah.
Or, yeah.
I mean, yeah, I guess I'm the one, you guys are still analog over there, I guess, whatever you call it. I got this 5-string here. It was made for me actually by a guy that I met through Suwannee, Uncle Billy, rest in peace. And this is his last fiddle that he made. But I got this extra low C string on here, and it really comes through when you plug it in, too.
Wow.
But I'm sure you talked to Daryl Langer or something. He's got like a million strings on his fiddles, doesn't he? Yeah.
If you don't know who Daryl Langer is, find out. He's kind of the father of a lot of contemporary crossover violin playing. He helped come up with this idea of the baritone violin? You want to talk about that?
I don't know much about it.
I don't know much about it. I know he puts octave strings on old fiddles sometimes, and it sounds really cool plugged in. He calls it the chin cello.
Oh yeah, chin cello.
Because it kind of goes into this register somewhere between like a viola, like a 17-inch viola, and a cello, and it's so these big thick strings, and it's optimally, like I have one that's a half size viola, which is a pretty close to the same scale or similar scale to a violin neck, but it's got a deep dish here, so it helps bring out the low C acoustically. Mm. But blah blah blah. Anyway. But Daryl, check out Daryl.
Yeah.
He's been my fiddle hero for since I was a kid. One of my biggest influences.
Was he your teacher?
In college, yeah.
Cool.
And then, he moved to Nashville a few years ago, so we've gotten to be really close.
Wow.
In Nashville. I feel really lucky.
It's cool to meet your heroes and be friends with them. Joe.
Lyndsay.
When I first heard Daryl play, it was on the first David Grisman Quintet record. I was in college, and I wasn't playing the fiddle yet, but I heard Daryl, and I said, I'll have what he's having, and he really inspired me to a large degree to pick this up. Daryl and he was like a kid then. Another violinist named Mark O'Connor, back in the day. Those two guys kind of. I was listening to something I hadn't heard before. And
Yeah. Put a little jazz in that bluegrass. You know, that's kind of what I liked about it.
And Daryl really. He was one of not the inventor of the chop, but. One of the biggest explorers of the chop technique, which is like playing drums on the fiddle, this kind of sound. Like using that sound with the bow to create rhythms and back up other musicians.
Right.
So that's the fiddle as percussion, like a percussionist, which is really, really cool.
Right, because when you're playing with someone else, you want to be able to back them up, you know, and take turns and accompany other people. And the chop really helps with that. Show us.
Oh yeah, chop. I let the kids do it.
It's basically, this is what it is at the core, just on the offbeats, like where a snare drum would go.
Right, or the mandolin chop.
Yeah. A lot of people have explored it more deeply than me, but you can be really playful with the rhythm, and you can add chords into it too. We could demonstrate on a tune.
Yeah, I know, that'd be cool.
It's a good way to stay out of the way when your friend's taking a solo. You can support the solo, and still be interacting with it, but not playing on top of it.
Right, especially because I think the fiddle being right by your ear, it's sometimes when it helps to kind of be able to hear what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And not, well, this can be like a little bit taking up sonic space in your ear, whereas if you're chopping, you can actually hear what the other person is playing a little bit more, I've noticed. But.
And it's fun to rhythmically respond to their ideas in the solo. Like, I love passing solos around, but it's really fun when you're all kind of, you view it as you're soloing together, and your backup is part of the solo too. So if Lyndsay did something cool rhythmically, like in her lead, and I could do that, kind of echo it rhythmically, that's really fun to listen and respond to each other in that way.
You guys demonstrate that. That would be really cool.
What about, I don't know, Big Sciota or something?
Sure, yeah.
Thank you.
Any questions about anything?
You have a question?
Yes? Mm-hmm. No?
In yes. the middle there?
Yes, sir.
What we're plugged into?
Gear. It's time for gear. Yeah.
Right, right.
Right. Right. Inquiring
we're looking
minds.
For, like gear that will hopefully mimic the sound as close as possible to the natural sound. That's what John and I were just talking about before we started.
We nerd out together on this a lot.
There's yeah, boy. Where do we begin with that? Okay, I'll start with, I'm using a DI preamp. So it's two things. Take a high impedance signal, quarter inch jack, into a box that converts it into a low impedance out for cleaner signal to the house or amp or wherever. And I'm using, with that DI, high to low impedance shift, a preamp to boost the signal before it even gets to its next source. Like sometimes people will buy a fiddle with a pickup and they'll just go plug it into an amp. And it's, you need, it works much more successfully if you have something that does a pre-boost or a preamp of signal to the next source. So I've got a thing called a red eye, and it's actually two of these preamp DIs in one little box. It's pretty small. And it's got separate tone and volume controls, so I can actually have two separate instruments going in with separate volume, but it's one line out, and I can switch over from one to the next. Does that make sense? Yeah, and that's what I'm using, and now Lyndsay. Oh, I'm using a Bags pickup that is embedded in the bridge, which is like one of the dumber things that they don't do this anymore, which is really great because if your bridge goes out on you, the amp the pickup goes
the
with
thing.
It. Yeah, you have to toss
the
whole
thing.
Oh, do you have the same thing?
I have the LR bags, too.
Yeah, they work the best.
They
That's
do.
The thing.
I tried all the pickups, and there's a couple that maybe sound better, but this is the easiest and most versatile, I think.
Right, and doesn't feed back. Yeah.
But the pickup, it really is embedded in the bridge. So, that aspect of it is good. But it's the thing of if something goes wacko with your bridge and you replace it, it's a shame to kind of, don't you think? I mean,
right. You have to replace the whole pickup with your bridge. Something happens to your bridge. Yeah.
Yeah.
I know.
But other than that, LR bags, great.
LR bags, yeah. I love my the DI that I use because it's trying to mimic the sound of your instrument through a microphone, and so you teach the DI the sound of your instrument. So you play your instrument into a microphone, which goes into the DI, and it learns the sound of your instrument, makes a wave map of it, and saves it. And it recreates that sound when you plug it in. So it's kind of cool. I think it sounds really natural, and it's called a Tone Dexter. And it's not expensive. Yeah, it's a preamp, yeah. Direct. DI box, yeah. What about you, John? He's got a unique thing.
I'm using the same preamp that Joe has, the Red Eye. And before that, I've been going into this, it's called a steel guitar black box. It's made for pedal steel. But it's subtle, but I miss it when it's not there now. It makes the high end feel a little more approachable to me. That's it. Usually I have a touch of reverb, like hopefully that's not noticeable, but just brings back some of the body sound that you miss when you plug in. Daryl says like reverb the size of a shoebox is appropriate for fiddle, because it's like you want a reverb that's the size of your instrument body. But I don't have any reverb on right now, it's just the preamp.
Another thing is EQing. You've got the gear, but then you need to know how to use it. And I always, oftentimes when I'm troubleshooting for somebody to listen to their thing, because they'll come up to me and say, wow, what are you using on your mandolin, or what are you using on your, is to show them, I mean, one of the first rules of thumb, for me anyway, is dip your highs, dude.
Yeah.
Dip the highs, because
right.
I mean, right?
Yeah. Right, yeah, fiddle players.
You want that, you want a buttery, warm thing. And the first time I heard really buttery and warm, because I was listening to early jazz recordings by some of my jazz violin heroes, my biggest one of which was a guy named Stuff Smith.
Yeah.
Gritty, but just so amazing and badass and just great, you know. And then I heard Stefan Grappelli, and I just like floated off on a big cumulus cloud.
I know.
And I was forever changed. And just getting that, you know, just like sort of finding what you like in your sound. Sometimes it's a reflection of the people that, these fiddle players that we listen to, who we all admire, and you know, they help guide us to get to that place, that sound. But I would say, learn to EQ, you know, drop some highs. I drop a fair amount of mids, and I boost my lows a little bit, and poof, I'm good. Poof. Yes.
Hi, Philip.
Oh, yeah.
I don't have that with me. Yeah, he's asking about my setup with the Stickley Trio. I have two DIs on my pedal board. So I run two lines out to the front, and I have an AB switch that switches between. So one DI is hooked up to an octave pedal. And that is set up so that I sound like the bass. And it's a big bass too.
What pedal do you use?
It's a Pog.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a Pog 2.
You so, gotta have a Pog. Every fiddle player needs a Pog.
Yeah.
I
know, I think I heard Bobby using one last night with Town Mountain.
Now there's different settings to kind of go, you can go lower than that, but I mean you can see that, you can already hear the difference.
It makes you play differently, doesn't
it? It does, and I gotta tell you, the sound that Lyndsay gets, absolutely stunning. I mean, she's really spent a lot of time really dialing it in. So what you see in the Stickley Trio is just, yeah. And that's magic, and that's using the gear in a way that's really super creative and successful.
Thank you.
Yeah, she's really, I mean, if you have, everybody here, John Stickley Trio, standard required listening here and dancing at Suwannee.
Yeah.
Thank you. Woo-hoo. That's so nice. Yeah, well, it's like if you give yourself a set of resources that's unconventional, then you just, it just makes you come up with, you know, you it's like John decided to make an instrumentation of drums, guitar, and fiddle. And we actually used to not use any bass at all for years. But that's, you gotta have the bass, you know? But, you know, so it's, you just figure it out. If you give yourself, you don't give yourself a bass player, you become one.
Making something up, I have no idea what I'm doing, and I feel like that I am at my artistic best when I don't know what I'm doing. So this is just an invitation. You just start playing, and you look at your pals, and you give them that sweet glow, and it's like, come on in, the water's fine. Thank you. seemed appropriate.
I know.
If only.
I know.
We're having so much fun up here, but what's important for me, is when I see people watching people play and they're really kind of going into a zone and they're really connecting and whatnot, is that we're having a blast and we're painting. We start out with blank canvases and we're filling the canvas with as much or as little paint as we want. But we really want to, for me, it's about reaching out to you all and connecting the value and the fun of this to you. I have always felt that, I really believe in my heart that everyone can make music. And that's kind of been my gig for 40 years, is to show people that you can make music. Then, because I want to empower you to say, I'm not interested in playing music, but I know that I can. That weird guy named Joe showed me that I can. So I'm making the decision not to play for the right reasons, not because you think you can't. Not because you think you can't. Did I say that right? There's always a little dyslexic with that, but yeah. Does that make sense? A lot of us have been raised, they've had a slap on the heart, which something somewhere along the way said, I can't do that, or I don't have enough talent, or I had my fifth grade teacher, Mrs. Crudup, said, music's probably not right for you. Holy moly. I mean, yeah. Or how many of you took piano lessons when you were a kid? Raise hands. Keep the hands up. Look around a little bit. Keep your hand up, sir. Thank you. Okay. Now, how many of you are playing still? So this is what's so cool about folk music. Folk music is social music. It's like, you know, and fiddlers, we're like this weird, cool tribe of people that just kind of, we're like, what's that thing in Lord of the Rings? Like, not that, we're not that weird, but the golem, you know, it's like, yeah. Oh, my precious. But you want to be with other my preciouses.
Yes.
And because it's the joy of it. And it doesn't really matter what instrument. It's the joy of this, and you can begin. Don't forget, and walk around doing that, and sing melodies, and you're there. You're connecting with the violin, and you can really feel the beauty and the intimacy and the power and all of that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, that's so cool.
Okay, so we've got, we'll take this out by playing something. Mm-hmm. Are there any other questions? Yes, ma'am. Sure, they're very different. I have one that I'm holding together with duct tape and gaff tape, because I have a split here, and this, this broke off when it fell, and I couldn't find the other piece. So it's been like that for years.
How long you had that fiddle?
I've had, this fiddle was given to me, I'm gonna try to tell you this without choking up. An 85-year-old woman had this fiddle when she was young, and she never learned how to play it, but she had a relationship with it. It's sort of like a doll. It had a spirit, it had a name, and she kept this fiddle all her life. And at age 85, she saw me do some education stuff and talk about a little bit about what I've been blabbing to you today. And she said, I think I have found a home for my fiddle. And I've been playing it ever since.
Aww.
So it's got a lot to say. It's not a really great fiddle, but it's a magical fiddle. And that and in a sense, that makes it great. And I use a cello bow.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Next.
It's really a cello bow?
It's a cello bow.
Whoa, crazy.
Why do you choose a cello bow?
Because I like a heavy stick. It's weird. And it happened by accident. I left my bows. I forgot to put them back in the case. And I was on a gig. And actually, this is a little bit extreme. The bass player, stand-up bass player, had a bass bow, And I borrowed his bass bow, because he went pits on the gig, and I played my fiddle with a bass bow. So people were taking lots of pictures, and like going, I can't believe he's doing this. This is like, but it worked. I got through the gig. I adapted. I'm a big fan of Charlie Darwin. It's not the smartest that survive. It's not the largest, the you know, whatever. It's the most flexible, the most adaptable that survive. Mm-hmm. So I had to adapt. And then I went, wow, that was really kind of cool. And so then I went to a viola stick, and I went to finally landed back on a cello bow because of that incident, that gig.
Wow, that's cool.
Okay,
that's cool.
On to you.
Well, I kind of already told you guys about my fiddle. It was made for me by this guy named Uncle Billy, a very special guy. And he makes 5 strings, and he makes these really, it's like his own, he's self-taught, and he makes really cool designs that are, it's asymmetrical. So it's, instead of the 4 points, it's got 2, it's got the hole in the scroll, and that was, all this stuff
that
was
awesome.
His thing,
that's
yeah.
That's really cool.
So thanks, Uncle Billy, for my fiddle. And it's a 5 string, yeah.
Mine was made by my friend in Portland, Maine, John Cooper, and I've had it for 15 years. It's my only fiddle, and I love it.
Yeah, that's cool.
He built it in 2005, and I got it in 2009.
You really get a relationship going with these things. It's very special.
Totally.
Beyond words. Okay, let's play.
Yeah.
What do you want to do? Thank you, by the way, for coming to this. And we've really had, this has been wonderful for the three of us and wonderful to share with you all.
What should we play?
Maybe it's slower. I don't know.
Waltz. And when we're done, if anybody's interested, I could show you something after the workshop.
Sure, yeah.
Oh, and by the way, you'll see John all through the weekend. He is our official artist at large this weekend, and I couldn't think of a better human being to be the artist at large, because
Yes. He's
a wonderful spirit, John is. Woohoo!
I like how John Mosier described you as a man without malice. It's like so true.
It's true. It's lovely. Okay.
All right. Do you know Lonesome Moonlight Waltz?
I could try. I mean, I could limp through it.
You know.
Yeah.
Do you like Tennessee Waltz or?
See, here's the other thing. They're saying, do you know this and do you know that? If you just courageously say, if you have some familiarity with it, get on the bus. You're gonna maybe make some different notes. But it could wind up being really cool because you don't know it. Does that make sense? That's where the new stuff comes from, you know, from oftentimes your creative mistakes.
Right.
They're just notes you didn't mean to play. That doesn't mean they're wrong or bad.
Yeah.
It's like, well, I'm reinterpreting.
Or you might know it. You might actually know it.
This is my reimagination of. Right. Okay. So I'm going to go into this not really knowing it the way these guys probably know it. So.
I should know this better than I do. Let's do it.
Okay. Are you gonna play the melody?
Do you know harmony part?
Yeah, I think so, pretty much.
I can do the melody.
Okay. All right.
John Mailander, everybody. Lyndsay Pruett.
Thank you. Joe Craven.
Lovely to be with all of you. Thank you so much. All rise.
Yeah. That was the midnight moonlight. Werewolves of London.